Welcome to Word of Faith Sunday night service. God is good, and it's so good to be here. We're excited. We're expecting what God's going to do in our service tonight. And we just are here to worship Him, to love on Jesus, to tell Him how much we love Him, and just to praise Him and adore Him. And He inhabits the praises of His people. And Lord, we just want to thank You tonight. We thank You, God, that You are in this place. God, we thank You for Your presence, sweet, sweet presence, oh God. And we just ask tonight that You would just be exalted above all the earth, oh God. We exalt You. We lift You high. We love You, God. We adore You tonight. We'll give You all our praise. And God, we're excited to see the Word revealed tonight to us, oh God, and a word spoken to us, oh God. We receive Your words, Lord. We're expecting and we receive already, oh God. And God, we just be with the worship team tonight as we lead people into worship, oh God, as we sound the praises of You throughout this earth, oh God. And all of heaven is praising with us, oh God. We thank You, Lord. We thank You. We worship You. We adore You, Lord. You are worthy. You are worthy. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Let's stand tonight. We're going to worship the Lord and let Him have His way tonight. Amen.
Praising His name, I just can't stop. Praising the name. Grace, I need to praise.
I need to praise the Lord. There's something about praise in heaven. Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you.
Sing a new song to Him. Jesus,
Jesus,
Lord,
Cheers.
Whether we call it revival or awakening, we just need God.
Yes.
Amen. I believe in these last days we're going to find that He's going to just pull out all the plugs.
Amen.
So that there'll be no excuse by anybody that they don't believe that God's real or God cares or God does this or does that. I believe He's going to show Himself so strong, so powerful, there will be no excuses. Hallelujah. Well, we want it to be here too, don't you?
Yes.
Why not here?
Why not
now? Why not us? Glory to God. That's such a good thing. Why not here?
You know, not
every church wants the Spirit of God to come. You know, I like to just, the Holy Spirit sometimes says, just get out of the way. Just get out of the way so He can do what He wants to do. Hallelujah. I think sometimes we get more in the way. There's a scripture in the Gospels that says, and I know it's a little bit taken out of context, it says, but the disciples were in the road, that says, and they were in the way. Sometimes we get in the way of what God wants to do, and I really want to get out of the way. Hallelujah. So we want to take up our regular Sunday night offering, and we have Pastor Neil and Prophet Neil and Pastor Emily with us, and who gets the pleasure tonight? Who's ministering here tonight? You know, we have another microphone, you both can do it. If you need an envelope, we'd be glad to help you out here. All right. And we will take up an offering a little bit later on for them.
Yes.
Let's say something good over our offering, all right?
Yes.
Say this with me, Heavenly Father.
Heavenly Father,
it's an honor.
It's
a privilege to be able to sow into the kingdom of God. Thank you, Lord, that you give me that opportunity.
Yes.
And what I do tonight, I do by faith. In Jesus' name. That what I sow, I'll reap it again. In Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's go ahead, ladies. So nice to have you here, Sister Falaki, tonight. I thought I could hear you singing back there. I thought, hallelujah. It's just so awesome to have everyone here tonight. And Prophet Neil, and you're back a little bit early, right?
Yes.
Okay, what happened? Anything unusual happen, or just they just cut you loose, or do you get to stay longer?
No. I just a few days early.
Okay, so are you still up in Pond Inlet?
I'm on my way there next.
Okay, and how long are you here for? 2 weeks? Or?
Yes.
All right, well, praise the Lord. That's good to know. So, well, thank you, Lord. Father, we just thank you tonight for Prophet Neil. We thank you for Pastor Emily, Father God, and whoever you want to use is just fine with us. They are both powerful. They are both anointed, Father God. Your Spirit rests upon them, moves through them, flows through them, Father God. Father, we pray that you will give them, their tongue will be as the pen of a ready writer tonight, Father God. We thank you for the precious gifts of the Holy Spirit to be in manifestation tonight, Lord. We thank you for the liberty. You said in your word, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. So, Father, your Spirit is here. That means there is liberty in the Holy Ghost tonight.
Yes.
And so, like we like to say, anything can happen tonight. Holy Spirit, you're welcome to move, manifest yourself, do whatever you want to do, however you want to do it. And so we just give you honor and glory. We are expecting tonight.
Yes, we are.
We are expecting, Father God. Just like that man at the gate called Beautiful, he looked up expecting to receive something. So, Father, we are expecting to receive something awesome tonight from the Holy Ghost. And we will not be disappointed. Like you said this morning, a word to the wise should be sufficient about being here tonight. And those that were wise are here tonight. So we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So, do we flip a coin tonight or what? All right. We're happy with that.
Hallelujah. It's so good to be in the house of the Lord tonight. Amen. It's so good to see all of your faces once again. Hallelujah. My husband wasn't due to be back. He was supposed to be back on Friday, this coming Friday. And he called me and he said, they asked me to stay 2 more weeks, to which I won't say what I said. Really? He called me Wednesday morning, and I like to start my mornings off really slow. So I was there in my jammies with my coffee, and he said, come and pick me up in an hour. And I said, what? He said, yeah, come in the next hour. I'll be at the airport. And I said, man, I would have planned my day a lot different yesterday if I hadn't known that you were coming home. But it was an awesome surprise, and I'm so glad that he is here. And I'm just excited about what the Lord has in store for us tonight. Be blessed, Sister Kim. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are here, moving in this place. I worship you. You are here, you're working in this place. I worship you.
Holy, 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 holy Experience the glory. majesty. Come on, sing this old song of the church with me. Unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. Majesty, O kingdom of glory. Come unto his own.
Thank you.
I want to pray for you again tonight. There's something God wants to do. I don't know your name. You're wearing the jean dress. Something God wants to do for you, my sister.
Go! Thank you. filling this place tonight. I started preaching when I was 13 years old, and it's been a couple years ago now. There's one thing that I've learned, Pastor, many years ago, is once God takes over, there's no sense in trying to top what God has already done. Aren't you glad you're in the house of the Lord tonight?
Yes.
There's no place I'd rather be than in His presence. David said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. See, I believe David recognized that there's something special when people of a like faith gather together. There's nothing more dangerous than when you get a handful of people together. See, the Bible said where there are two or three are gathered, He said, there I am in the midst. When you get a few people together that love the Lord and they begin to worship the Lord, see, the Bible teaches us the principle that as our praises and as our worship goes up towards heaven, His glory and His presence comes in. And there was definitely some worship in this place. Because I could feel His presence. The healing power of God was in the building. Oh, we just love the Lord. We just love the Lord. Oh, I thank You, Jesus. You are a mighty God. You are a mighty God. Tells us that we are to prophesy according to our measure of faith.
Yes.
How many of you ever read that? It said, prophesy according to the measure of faith.
Yes.
See, when you read the Word of God, there's a lot in the Bible about prophecy.
Yes.
There's a lot of how God speaks to His people, how God speaks through His people. When you read the Word of God, there's several ways of how God speaks to His people. But when it comes to prophecy, there's a lot of stuff out there on the topic of prophecy. When you read the Word of God, we see prophecy coming in several different ways. We see it coming directly from a prophet. You see, when a prophet prophesies, he doesn't just prophesy when he feels inspired, but literally the Word of God tells us that there were prophets in the Bible that when they spoke, that God would not let one of those words fall and hit the ground. I'm reminded of the story when the prophet was walking down an old dirt road, and the Bible said there were some children that came out and they began to mock the prophet. They begin to say, you're a bald head. They begin to say things to him. And the Bible says that the prophet turned and he cursed those children. And the Bible said that a she-bear came out of the woods and it ripped those children apart and ripped them in pieces. And I was asked one day, was that God's will in that moment for that prophet to prophesy over that children? And I said, that's one of those moments where God does not allow the prophet's words to hit the ground. How many of you know it's a dangerous thing when you touch God's anointed? In fact, the Bible very clearly says, touch not mine anointed and do my prophets no harm. See, a prophet is not something that somebody gets taught. It's not something you get like a degree. You don't go to a school and then come out and then you are a prophet. A prophet is something that God makes you. It's something that He put His hand upon you when you were still in your mother's womb. But when it comes to prophecy, it's not just a prophet that prophesies. When we get into the New Testament, it tells us to prophesy according to the measure of faith, that faith that is on the inside of us. The Bible said faith is the substance of things hoped for. It is the evidence of things not seen. Faith, I believe, is something that God deposits on the inside of us. And I believe that we grow that faith. We exercise in that faith. The Bible said God builds line upon line and precept upon precept. And I've always loved services like this because I believe it's services like this that God begins to stir that faith on the inside of you. And if you ever wonder what that prophesy according to your measure of faith is, it's when you're in a service just like this and the Spirit of God is moving and all of a sudden you start feeling something moving on the inside of you. And all those areas in your life that you thought that you were going to fail, you were going to fall apart, they were never going to get saved, all of a sudden something starts stirring on the inside of you and it tells you, wait a minute, maybe I am going to get healed. Wait a minute, Maybe my children are going to serve the Lord. Wait a minute, maybe this mountain that's in front of me that looks like it's so big that there's no way that I can climb over it. Something begins to stir up on the inside of you and it tells you you're bigger than you think you are. You're stronger than you think you are. The God that you serve is bigger than any Goliath that's on the out there that's coming again. Have you ever experienced something like that where you're in a service just like this and you feel, wait a minute, I feel like those chains are getting ready to break. I feel like my miracle is getting ready to happen. Well, that is God stirring your faith. And that's the point in your life where the worst thing you can do is sit back and be quiet. The best thing that you can do is in that moment get up is begin to prophesy. If nobody will prophesy to you, you prophesy to yourself. If you're sitting there and all of a sudden the waters are troubled inside of your spirit and you start feeling like your miracle is just one step away, that's when you need to begin to lay hands on yourself and you need to begin to prophesy those children serving God. You need to begin to prophesy that body being healed. You need to begin to prophesy that church being filled. Prophesy that door that seems like it was closed and it'll never be opened. You need to begin to proclaim it shall be opened in the name of the Lord. This body shall be healed. Come on, somebody say amen. You need to declare it. You need to decree it. You need to believe it. Come on, somebody say amen. And I believe with all of my heart that when you speak it, that God will bring his word to pass. Because how many of you know when God sends his word forth, he does not return back void. Come on, somebody say amen. When he sends his word forth, it doesn't come back with nothing, but it comes back with results. When God says he's going to heal you, he's going to heal you. When God said he's going to save your family, come hell or high water, those family members are coming in. Come on, somebody say amen. You need to prophesy. When that faith is stirring on the inside of you, prophesy, prophesy. If you when you're done prophesying to yourself, you need to look at your neighbor and declare life, declare healing, declare salvation, declare revival. Come on, somebody say amen. You need to prophesy. Prophesy according to the measure of your faith. Oh, God did something special in this place tonight. Oh, he did something special in this place tonight. Hallelujah.
I'm thinking about maybe having a fall conference, maybe with Pastor Emily and Prophet Neil, maybe Pastor Brian Bork, and you know, maybe up in maybe November, something like that, early November, before the weather gets too bad. So we'll get with you and see if we can't work something out. It seems like it's just floating around. We'll have to work it out with your schedule, Prophet Neil, but it seems like there's something the Lord would like to do. And so we need to be praying about these things. God wants to do so much more than we've ever dreamt. He's bigger than we can imagine. Okay? He can do things that just are just unheard of. You know, just one service here, one service when Brother Begley was here, he's a prophet, and he had done the message and the ministry, and I turned to him, he was sitting there, and I said, you didn't finish it. You're supposed to do something yet. He said, yes, that's right. He didn't know what it was. He got up and prophesied. Within a few minutes, we had $100,000 come in into our building fund. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Well, God's a God of suddenlies.
Yes.
God is a God of suddenlies. There's nothing too hard. There's nothing too difficult. He's this awesome healer. You know, God's got a plan. God has a plan. He has a plan for you and for your life and for your future. Okay? Nothing takes God by surprise. All right? Sometimes we get surprised. God's not surprised. But one of the things I've learned over I've been in this for probably close to 50 years now, is that if you walk with God and you serve Him, you'll always come out on top. No matter what the devil throws at you, no matter what happens to you, if you just stick with it, you will come out on top. He's just that kind of God. I've had some not very nice things happen in my life over the years. But every time I've had people say, well, are you going to quit serving God? And I said, no, I'm going to keep on going. I like to say this, I've gone too far. I'm in too deep. There is no way to turn around. I cannot go back. And so, you know, when you live like that, you talk like that, he's got responsibilities. He's got to take care of you. He has it. He says, well, I got to do something for them now because they're still trusting me. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Well, in 1 Corinthians, in chapter 16, verse 1, it says, now concerning the collection for the saints, as I have given orders to the churches in Galatia, even so do ye upon the first day of the week, that every one of you lay by him in store, as God has prospered him, that there be no gathering when I come. Notice that Paul seemed to believe in prosperity. God believes in prosperity because he just said that God, as God has prospered you. As God has prospered you. Well, there's a reason that God prospers us, and that's so that we can be a blessing to ministries and ministers and touch them and help them out. And help, you know, they have needs. You know, I don't know about you, but I found that ministers have financial needs, financial crises, you know. Hard places, deep places, unexpected bills, you know. Washing machines die, cars die. All of a sudden, you're facing some really big expenditures. And but God has people in the body of Christ that can help make a difference. And so if you'll look into your heart as to what to give, God will help you. Okay? And so if you need an envelope tonight for your giving, we got some people that will help you tonight. Hallelujah. Were you blessed tonight?
Yes.
Oh, my. It is. It was awesome tonight. And we're just, we had had a word for Pastor Emily some weeks ago. And I had spoke to her in my office. I showed her a picture of Lester Summerall. And he had been in my church several times and had laid hands upon me. And so I felt led. I told her, I said, one service I'd like to lay hands upon you. Because Smith Wigglesworth had laid his hands upon Lester Summerall. Yes. And then Lester Summerall laid his hands upon me, and Kenneth Hagin laid his hands upon me, and Norval Hayes has laid his hands upon me, and R.W. Schonbach has laid his hands upon me. And so I've had a number of people, but the anointing went into me. I like to tell this little story, and maybe Pastor Emily's already heard it. But when I went to, after I got out of school, I started my church, getting ready to start my church, and Brother Hagin was laying hands on people for the ministry, and I was just thrilled. Brother Hagin was going to lay hands on me, and so I was excited, I was thrilled about it, and he laid hands on me for the ministry. The only thing was, I wasn't thinking about the ministry, I was just thinking about Brother Hagin laying hands on me. So several years later, it dawned on me, I need to get my head screwed on straight. I need to ask and see if I can't get him to lay hands on me, because I'm ready to receive now. Right. I'm ready to receive. And so I had a good friend who was actually Kenneth Hagin's best friend, Doc Horton. And I said to Doc, I said, do you think you could make it somehow that you could get Brother Hagin to perhaps lay his hands on me again, because I'm ready to receive it this time. He said, well, I suppose we could work something out. And as I was just meditating on it, the Lord said to me, he said, when Kenneth Hagin laid his hands on you, did he do that in faith? I said, well, of course he did it in faith. Yeah. He said, then why don't you receive? Now, years have gone by. He said, why don't you receive what he did then?
Wow.
I said, you can do that? He said, yes, you can. And so that moment, I said, I received what Kenneth Hagin did, and immediately that anointing came into me. I never did have to go back and ask him again. Okay? Why? Because that anointing is there. It gets stirred up. And so I think we're seeing some of that, the effects of that laying out of hands some weeks ago for Pastor Emily. And it was prophesied, you know, that she'd go move in these things. And, you know, when you just start stepping out into the unknown, step out into that void, you'll find out that you walk on water, okay? You're walking on water. You're moving in the gift of the Spirit. And it's awesome to see, because that changes lives. The Word changes lives, but the manifestations of the Spirit also change lives. Amen? That anointing, it breaks the yokes. Amen? Destroys the yokes. Hallelujah. Are we ready? I didn't mean to preach. Father, we thank you. Let's say that together. Father, we thank you. I thank you for the ministry that was happened here tonight. It was glorious. It was awesome. And I was here in the middle of it. In the middle of the glory. And I received tonight. And I'll continue to receive. Long after the service is over, the residue of the glory will continue to manifest in my life, in my home, and in my body. In Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's go ahead. Praise the Lord. Yeah, we want to bless him really, 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 really good. Amen. Glory to God. Well, the Lord is so, so good. We're thrilled about what God is doing. I'm just so thrilled for Pastor Emily and Prophet. I really love them. I appreciate them. I just, you know, when we first, I've been wanting to have her come for the longest time. It's just trying to work it out where we could get her together. She's been in the office a time or two, sat in my office and cried, and we prayed and talked about the things of God. But then one day, you know, there's a timing for everything. There's just a timing. And it was our time now. And so we have developed into a really good friendship, and it's going to come into that a really great friendship too.
Yes.
And we're going to see our city changed.
Yes.
Okay? It's not about Word of Faith Church, but it's about all of us as the body of Christ coming together and seeing that what God is going to do. You know, this city needs to be saved. Okay, very dark place sometimes in the city. But anyway, well, praise the Lord. Thank you so much for coming. Don't forget, we have a Tuesday night prayer here, and it's prayer is so important. We pray for services like this. They have the war room every couple weeks on Friday morning. That's a very, very powerful type of prayer. And so, again, there's so many things going on. Well, we love you. God bless you. Thank you for coming.